Hey everybody, welcome back. I'm Seth Monahan, a guy who fished a 6-foot snake out of his pool last month. And today is the day you're finally gonna learn about 3 and 7 in minor keys. So, one of the most common questions I get from viewers is, why don't you ever talk about the 3 chord? What's going on there? And it's a reasonable question. I mean, if you think about it, 3 is the only Roman numeral that doesn't appear anywhere in the Big 18. There's just nothing in that column. And now, 17 videos later, with all the new chords we've learned, we still haven't even glimpsed a 3 chord. So it's true, I've been avoiding it. And the main reason is that 3 is one of those weird chords that does totally different things in major and minor keys. It's extremely rare in major and usually appears in things called sequences, which we haven't talked about yet. And though it does get used in minor a lot, there's one pretty big caveat, which I'll show you right now. Here are the diatonic chords we see all the time in minor. And at this point, you probably know how they're used and what functions they have. A progression like this one should be full of very familiar sounds. But notice as well that I've left a few gaps in the diagram. Why did I do that? Well, I did it to leave room for 2 other diatonic chords in minor, neither of which we've seen much before. One is the missing mediant triad, aka the relative major, and the other is its sidekick, basically, the subtonic triad. Remember that that's the chord built on lowered scale degree 7. It's a major triad, and it gets the uppercase Roman numeral 7. Now, 15 videos back, I explained why these 2 chords aren't in the Big 18. But on the off chance that you can't remember, I want to play them for you first and see if you can figure it out yourself. Let's take the progression on screen and swap out just the last 2 chords. So instead of 4-6 going to 5, I'm going to drop in, oh, I don't know, root position 7 going to root position 3. And when I play it, ask yourself what that change does to your sense of A minor as the tonic note. Now, you might have noticed something curious there, but if you didn't, let's try again. But now I'll make the subtonic chord a 7-7 instead. Okay, I'm willing to bet that if you listened carefully, those last 2 chords didn't sound like they were even in A minor at all. They sounded like 5-7 going to 1 in C major. And that's the caveat. 7 and 3 in minor can make it sound like we're leaving the minor key altogether and tilting into the relative major. And there are, I think, 2 reasons for this. One is that the subtonic chord, big Roman numeral 7, is also 5 of 3. That makes the subtonic 7th 5-7 of 3. So just that relationship has the potential to make 3 sound like a wannabe tonic. But even deeper than that is a second reason. These 2 chords both contain a note, a single note that we've only rarely come across as a chord tone. That note is the subtonic itself, the lowered version of scale degree 7. Now, why is the subtonic such a problem? Well, it's a problem not so much for what it is as for what it isn't. And the thing that it isn't is the leading tone. Anytime the subtonic appears as a chord tone, the leading tone, the raised version of 7, is forced out of the picture. And from there, the dominoes can fall easily. Without the leading tone, you can't have a dominant function. And without the dominant function to point us toward tonic, it's really easy to lose our sense even of where the tonic is. And if at the same time we start hearing chords that sound like 5-7 going to 1 in some other key, well, it's gonna feel like we're just changing keys. And this brings us to one of today's big takeaway points. When 3 and 7 appear in minor, it's usually a sign that we're about to change keys. The 7 is going to sound like a new 5, and then 3 is going to sound like a new tonic. In many ways, the progression on screen does exactly that. It changes keys without even trying. But since we haven't learned about modulation yet, I'm going to avoid full-blown key changes today. We'll actually learn about those in the next video. Today, I want to look at a much less common situation, which is when 3 and 7 appear in minor without causing a change of key. When this happens, and it does happen, a whole new harmonic color enters into the music, a kind of major mode aura, but not in a way that undermines the main key. Our job today is to learn to hear that particular color shift. And we're going to start by rewinding to the early 1700s, when this was a more common sound than it would be like 100 years later. On screen is the last of Vivaldi's Opus 1 Trio Sonatas, and it's based on another one of these chord progressions that actually has a special name. But unlike the one we sort of learned about in video 31, this one was actually named by people in the Baroque period. They called it La Folia, and its roots go back even 100 years before this. But the version on screen was the most common one in the 1700s. Everybody used it. Vivaldi, Corelli, Scarlatti, Purcell, and literally dozens of other composers. And the thing we want to notice here is that within this single phrase, which starts and ends in D minor, there's a brief glimpse of F major via 3 and 7. The first two bars move from tonic to dominant. But then the second two bars move from tonic to 5 of 3, and then on to 3, where the second half of the phrase starts. But then, in the middle of bar 6, Vivaldi takes that subtonic in the bass and hoists it up a half step, giving us the leading tone that will pull us back into the orbit of D minor. And from there, it's just a boilerplate progression leading to the half cadence. I want you to notice a few things here before we listen again. First, as we move toward the 3 chord, as that relative major sound sneaks in, notice that the melody rises by step. This is surprisingly common. We're going to see it in about half of today's examples. Second, I want you to notice how much the motion into 3 feels like a significant arrival. We may not be in the key of F major, but for a moment, F feels almost as stable as if it were the tonic. That's why I'm giving 3 the function T in scare quotes. It's not tonic, but it's tonic-like in the sense that it's a chord that feels more restful than restless. And following that, I'm going to give 7, aka 5 of 3, a dominant function in scare quotes, since that's how it relates to 3. Here's the whole thing. Now, we're not done with La Folia yet. I've actually got 2 more variants of it lined up for you. Here's a version that Handel wrote in 1706, only a year after Vivaldi's. It's still an 8-bar phrase, and it still gets much of its character from that move through the relative major. But Handel has moved some things around and made it a little more systematic. Now it's built as a series of root position chords grouped in pairs, with the bass leaping up by 5th within each pair. So we start on tonic and move up by 5th to 5. Then we do the same thing starting on the relative major. So now it's 3 moving to 7. Next comes 4 moving by a plagal motion back to tonic. And then the last 2 bars move into the half cadence through a diatonic lament bass. Here's hears the whole thing in an arrangement for historical instruments. Now, Handel's version of the Folia progression is obviously different from Vivaldi's, but they share a certain old-fashioned sound, thanks in part to those casual lapses into the relative major. That's a sound we don't hear nearly as often in, say, Haydn or Mozart. But maybe because of this old-fashioned sound, Romantic composers occasionally use the Folia progression as a kind of novelty or bit of exoticism. And I was, I will admit, surprised to learn from Wikipedia that Beethoven himself snuck it into his Fifth Symphony, of all things. Here's a passage you may recognize from the slow movement, and this time I'm going to play it first and then analyze it. When it plays, keep your ear out for that telltale move to three. We're in A flat minor here. So the progression you're listening for is this. Now, we're obviously going to need some room here, so let's strip the texture down to its bare bones. And what we find is that Beethoven's Folia is pretty much identical to Vivaldi's. But with a few extra ones and fives tacked on at the end. The only difference is actually one that makes it sound more archaic. Look at how Beethoven gets back to tonic in the seventh bar. When Vivaldi was in the orbit of three, he reintroduced the leading tone to bring us closer to the tonic. If Beethoven had done this, we'd have G naturals right around here. But instead, Beethoven goes straight from 5 of 3 to the minor tonic. It's a really striking sound, almost a kind of a modal flavor. Here's the whole passage again. So now we're going to leave the Folia progression behind and listen to some early romantic pieces that also use 3 and 7. For the moment, I'm going to stick with Beethoven, though we need to leap from the Fifth Symphony to the perhaps less well-known Bagatelle Opus 33 number 2. This isn't even the beginning of it, it's the middle of it. The first thing we need to do here is reduce the left-hand part to show how simple the actual bass line is. It moves entirely by step until the PAC at the end, and since it doesn't contain the subtonic note, there's nothing about it that suggests we might tilt toward the relative major. The first eight bars dip down from tonic and rise to scale degree three. And then the second eight echo this a third higher with a fifth drop at the end. Again, nothing here suggests a tilt toward the relative major, but that's exactly what we get. Here's the essential counterpoint of this first phrase. And as you can see, Beethoven harmonizes the 1-2-3 bass line differently from what we might expect. Instead of tonic, dominant, tonic, he uses 5-6 of 3 to get to 3, which is a much more stable place to land. Then in the second system, the bass continues to rise, bringing us back into A minor with a standard predominant dominant tonic motion. When we bring back the left hand and listen to the whole excerpt, notice how the melody rises by step as we move into three at the end of the first system. Remember, that's a thing. Also pay attention to where three turns up in the phrase. Like all of the excerpts so far, this one divides cleanly in half. But this is the first time we've ended the first half on a stable three chord. That strong arrival, along with the fact that the three chord sustains for seven whole bars, makes this one feel almost like a full-blown modulation to C major. All right, next up is, more Beethoven, actually. This is from the slow movement of the fourth piano concerto, and it's similar to the last one in that the first half ends on three. But there are differences, too. When I play the first system, notice above all how weakly the tonic E minor is represented compared to the very strong arrival on three. So you probably noticed that there's no root position tonic in that system, not at the beginning and not anywhere else. And by contrast, the arrival on three is extremely strong. Not only do we have the expected 5-7 of three, we also have an A minor triad, which is of course four in E minor, but also two in G major. So the move into three is actually a full-blown 2-5-7-1. That being said, notice that this strong arrival on G major is immediately rolled back, since the second system starts with a strong dominant of E minor. Here's the whole thing. Minutes ago, I mentioned that romantic composers sometimes used 3 and 7 for a sort of exotic effect, or as like a symbol for music outside the Austro-Germanic mainstream. Mendelssohn does this in the opening of his G minor Song Without Words, Opus 19, number 6. The piece is called Venetian Gondola Song, and the introduction has a really bold move to 3 just before the cadence. This is not a common progression in Mendelssohn. But there are three quote-unquote gondola songs in this collection, and it turns up in all three of them. So I think there's a good chance he was using it to capture what he thought of as some kind of Mediterranean folk idiom. Here's the introduction again, along with the first phrase of the main theme, which we studied a few videos back because of its long tonic pedal. Now it's time for some Schubert. This is the main theme from the Andante of the Great C Major Symphony. It's a 9-bar phrase that falls into three sections of different lengths. The first three bars sit on the minor tonic for a bit and then move to three as the melody rises by step. The next two bars reset the minor tonic by putting the leading tone in the bass. And then the last four bars have an extended predominant moving to a half cadential five with a bunch of chromatic chords we're basically going to ignore right now. Here's the entire phrase. Now, as it happens, those nine bars are the antecedent of a large parallel period. And in the consequent phrase, which I'll play for you in a second, Schubert gives the three chord a little more airtime by transposing these two bars up by third. But as before, we don't really change keys. The phrase ends with a clear PAC in the tonic. Next up is Chopin, who often starts his minor mode pieces with a little nod to the relative major. This is the G minor Mazurka, opus 67, number 2, and it starts with a pair of parallel 5-to-1 motions in the tonic minor, and then the relative major. And before we go on, I want to point out a cool detail in bar 2. On that last beat, Chopin turns the G minor tonic triad into a first inversion E flat major triad. And for thinking in terms of G minor, that's 6-6, but surely you know by now that 6-6 is most emphatically not a thing. But if we try to make sense of it in relation to the relative major, B flat, it becomes 4-6, which I like, because it means that we arrive on the three chord with not just a dominant, but also a predominant as well. At any rate, this is one of those excerpts that jumps from three immediately back into the tonic minor. The second system, we have a closing 5-1 progression followed by a few subdominant motions. Here's the entire phrase. And our last example today takes us back to Schubert. This is kind of a weird theme from his very last piano sonata. It starts and ends in F sharp minor, but in the third and fourth bars, it swings toward and away from the relative major not once, but twice. When I play it, I want you to start just by noticing how many times Schubert toggles between raised and lowered scale degree 7 in just these three bars. Hopefully you noticed five changes to the note E. We start with E sharp, the leading tone, which goes to E natural, the subtonic, and then back to E sharp, and then back to E natural again, and finally ending the phrase with E sharp back in the mix. Now, what does all this mean in terms of actual chords? Let's zoom in on those last three bars. What we find is that after the opening tonic chord, Schubert sets up a series of three dominant to tonic motions, first in the tonic, then the relative major, and then the tonic again. So when he goes to 5-7-3 a second time, of course we're expecting another move to A major, like this. But that's not what we get. Instead, Schubert resolves that dominant deceptively to 5-6-5 of the tonic key. For a quick, like half-cadence effect at the very last moment, keeping us squarely on track in the tonic. Now, what we've heard so far is actually the antecedent, once again, of a large parallel period. Here are the two phrases together. The second one is almost identical, except for one chord. See if you can find it. So, I bet you noticed that the one change is the very last chord. Instead of swerving back to the dominant of F sharp minor at the end, Schubert finally lets that big 5-7-3 resolve to the relative major, ending the phrase on a big PAC in A major. And now I do mean in A major, because from there the music just stays in A. So this, unlike any of our previous examples, is a full-blown modulation, an actual change of key, which gives us a good segue to video 34, where we're finally going to learn how modulation works. I'll see you then.